Meanwhile, speaking in the last few hours, Labour leader Sir Keir Starmer has said that a ceasefire would only embolden Hamas, as he defended his position on the issue amid a Labour revolt. He has called instead for humanitarian pauses in the fighting to allow more aid into Gaza and to allow people to flee.
And on the ground, humanitarian agencies say aid trucks are being delayed into Gaza and hospitals there are overflowing with wounded civilians and displaced people. But some good news perhaps overnight, as Israeli teenage hostage Ori Megadish was rescued from Hamas by the IDF and reunited with her family.
Joining us now is Colonel Simon Diggins, military and defence analyst. Tell us, what I'm confused about, Simon, is this. So, for about best part of 3 weeks, the world was on the edge of its seat. When is the ground invasion going to start? When is it going to start? America's urging restraint, Britain's urging, it's not. And then, suddenly, the tanks rolled in, and it barely made the papers. So, suddenly, it seems to me we are having the ground invasion. People are not reporting it as extensively as I imagined it would, but the New York Times has talked about this shroud of secrecy, you know, the invasion that we're not really noticing. I mean, what is going on there exactly?
I think initially people expected a very large-scale invasion, instant mobilisation. People thought there'd be instant offensive. The situation for the Israelis is very complicated. We know that Hamas are dug in. We know they're expecting an Israeli counterattack. We also know they have an extensive tunnel network throughout the Gaza Strip, which allows them to move men, supplies, ammunition, and indeed the hostages around the whole time. And the Israelis, therefore, are taking their time about understanding the situation. If you want to describe it in a very physical terms, they're kind of feeling the situation. Mm-hmm. They're trying to work out where the opposition are, where the Hamas terrorists are, where the hostages are, and therefore they're moving very slowly and very cautiously. And they've got they've got certain disadvantages. We know it's the largest single mobilisation the Israelis have ever done, but nonetheless, they're still a small country, and 300,000 people in a busy built-up area does not go very far, because fighting built-up areas, which is what they'd be expected to do, is very complicated and will absorb a lot of people. So they're taking their time.
So there we are, Simon, because joining us now is Israeli government spokesperson Tai Heinrich. Welcome, Tal. Tell us about this. Netanyahu last night, I thought, was extremely powerful in that press conference. Basically, I keep saying the rest of the world feels like a kind of debating society where you've got so many urges, let's have a ceasefire, humanitarian, etc., etc. Last night, we learned what Israel's true position was, and there is no chance of a ceasefire anytime soon, is there?
That is correct. If you listen carefully to the Israeli prime minister yesterday, he referred to this counteroffensive in Gaza against Hamas, the one that we were dragged into and didn't start and didn't want and weren't even expecting. He defined it as Israel's second war of independence, because this is, I can tell you, really reflective of the public sentiment here in Israel. It is a matter of life and death to us. It is that serious. We have faced an existential genocidal threat, and we have decided as a nation that we will no longer accept life next to this terrorist enclave that is ruled by Hamas. This is the only reason why we are operating in Gaza right now. And Kevin, to your question, a ceasefire is not an option. Can you imagine anyone around the world calling for a ceasefire with Boko Haram after they kidnapped 300 schoolgirls in Nigeria in 2014, a ceasefire right after 9/11. In fact, you know, there was a ceasefire. There was a ceasefire on October 6th, then Hamas broke it on October 7th. This is the only reason why the IDF is operating in Gaza right now. And anyone in the international community who is calling for a ceasefire right now is serving the pro-Hamas position, playing right into their hands, right into their strategy. This is what we're doing, because we cannot allow terrorists to get away with what they did here. These horrendous atrocities, ISIS-style atrocities. The German chancellor was here, Olaf Scholz, a few weeks ago, and he said that this is Nazi level, what he saw here.
Tal, you talk about Israeli public sentiment. You also talk about those who join calls for a ceasefire, playing into the hands of Hamas. Would that involve the UN? It seems to me that UNICEF spokespeople go around quoting Hamas statistics on fatalities as fact. Indeed, the Palestinian UNICEF spokesman appeared in something he said to imply child deaths were not merely collateral damage. And certainly Israel's relationship with the UN doesn't seem to be in fine fettle at the moment. Are you concerned about that and the reaction of the international community?
Well, you are 100% correct. We should not take any numbers or any kind of reports coming out of Gaza at face value, because there's no free speech there. There's no free press. Hamas are the people with the guns. They control anything, any kind of information that, you know, is coming out of there. It's just like taking, you wouldn't take numbers out of North Korea at face value, right? So that is how we should treat the numbers coming out of Gaza. However, of course, there are civilian casualties, and it is breaking our hearts as well. Because this is all the doing of Hamas. Hamas are responsible for what's happening in the Gaza Strip, and they are committing a double war crime. First, when they target the civilian population in Israel, and second, as they cynically use the population in Gaza as human shields. They are embedded on purpose in civilian urban structures. They dug themselves under hospitals and schools and youth centers and mosques and whatnot. They are doing it on purpose. So, and their strategy, they are hoping that the international community, as you described, will exert pressure on Israel. When international players are doing that, it means that they are playing right into Hamas's strategy, because they will do it again and again and again. They see that using human shields, as Palestinian civilians as human shields, is working, because Israel gets the fire of the international community. This is why we call on the civilized world. If you want to see this war ending, it has to be a total victory for Israel, with the elimination of this terror threat. And standing by Israel means standing by peace and quiet and calm in this region.
Thanks, Tal. Let's go back to you, Colonel Simon Diggins, military defense analyst. Tal making it very clear that the Israelis they've embarked on a war. We are on a war footing. The invasion is underway, and they're edging ever closer to the metropolis of Gaza. Once you get into that terrain, that's the worst terrain possible in which to fight a war. We're looking at a long-term conflict here, aren't we?
We are. I mean, the analysis was different from the initial assessment. Initial assessment was that the Israelis would try and follow their normal tactics, what you might describe as a quick, decisive victory, overwhelming force, minimum casualties, and sort the thing out very quickly. They're recognising that faced with an urban terrain like this, and all the complications of civilians, all the complications of hostages, and this is the actual physical terrain itself, we could be looking at months, even up to a year, and some analysts are talking about that. And Netanyahu has already warned the Israelis this is not going to be a short six-day war equivalent. It's going to take time.
Amid this, sorry, Alex, just one more question, sure. Simon. Amid this this escalating conflict, yeah, this difficult terrain for a war, all the tanks going in, soldiers on foot soon, I imagine, what are the realistic chances of the 200 or so hostages being released? Found and released, or released by Hamas?
Well, we had one very released last night, and I think that would probably be a significant intelligence operation which led to that. And that sort of release can also happen as well. I hope that within Hamas, and with people who are talking to Hamas, there are people of good faith, good common sense and goodwill, who can recognise that hostage taking is a particularly wicked form of warfare, and that if they really care about the Palestinian people, they will release them. Realistically, though, I mean, it is going to be hard and it's going to be difficult. And of course, one tactic, which would be a very brutal tactic of Hamas, might be trying to use them as human shields. I mean, these are horrible things to say, but it's a horrible form of warfare.
We heard at the start of this conflict a lot of saber-rattling coming from Iran, their foreign minister posting on Twitter that any incursion into Israel and they would essentially set missiles against Israel. We had reports of a drone being shot down, which is believed to have come from Yemen. What is the risk the further that this goes on, the bloodier it becomes, that this spills out into the wider region and becomes a far greater conflagration?
And that is also a realistic danger. I mean, the Iranians have talked about what they call the axis of resistance. And so for them, it's themselves, the heart of it, Hezbollah from the Lebanon, Hamas in Gaza, and the Houthi rebels also in Yemen. And there are also reports of missiles being fired and drones being used from there. So that is there. I mean, it is part of a wider issue. There's a debate which won't be resolved probably for years about the timing of the Hamas incursion. But it seems to be linked to attempts to derail what looked like a growing rapprochement between Israel and Saudi Arabia, which itself is part of a wider movement through the so-called Abraham Accords, whereby Israel and other and Muslim countries have been talking to each other. Now, what they're all unfortunately missing out is Palestine and dealing with Palestine. I think that's the missing piece from there. And it gives an opportunity then to troublemakers like the Iranians to try and stir up trouble. And I think that's the missing piece at the moment.
As this conflict escalates and potentially brings in other countries, particularly Iran, Syria, all the neighbouring Arab countries could get involved. Israel is pretty awesomely powerful militarily, but can it defend itself on all borders, on all fronts?
I mean, it probably can. I mean, it's done it before. I mean, you look at the wars it's fought in 67 or in 73, you know, it took on all comers and won, and it won militarily. The big challenge for Israel is not can they win on the battlefield. They've won the battlefield many, many times. But can they somehow win the peace? And that's going to be much more complicated. It's a big political issue. And I would say, really, at the moment, my sense at the moment, they're not really addressing that. Of course, they're angry, absolutely rightly so. What Hamas did was absolutely outrageous, horrific and terrible. And there's no doubt about that. But there is a peace to be won here. And whether they win the peace or whether through the way they conduct the war, they don't get there, I think is something they need to consider. And there are many people who are saying to them, think about the long term, think about the peace. How are you going to make peace from this war?
Well, someone who certainly doesn't want peace, it seems, is Tehran. And there is a big information war going on here, a huge propaganda war, not just about what's happening in Gaza itself, with a lot of fake atrocities being posted in short videos on social media platforms like TikTok, but intelligence in the UK now reporting on Iran's hand involved in the organisation and mobilisation of people in our pro-Palestine protests here. Yeah. How vigilant must we be against people like the Iranian Revolutionary Guard operating within UK territory and actually inciting unrest on our own streets?
No, very much so. We've heard reports, and I think they're credible reports, of sort of Palestine solidarity societies amongst our universities, basically having sort of Zoom meetings with the IRGC, Revolutionary Guard Corps commanders back in Tehran. Now, that's, you know, you can talk about free speech, you can talk about an open conversation. I suspect they probably weren't very critical open conversations as well. So that's the issue. Now, how do we deal with that? I think we deal with it through education. We deal with it by helping our young people particularly to understand how complicated the situation is and make sure they do receive a variety of views. But if you're talking about sort of an official organisation or official society within a university, universities have the power and authority to actually say, this is not acceptable. These are not people you can deal with, or you need to deal with them, like eating with the devil, you dine with a long spoon. We need to try and educate them to think in those terms and not just simply accept propaganda coming out of the IRGC.
Can I slightly go off piste there? Obviously, there's a lot of tension here all over the world to do with this Middle Eastern crisis. And obviously, the tension in the Middle East, Israel, Gaza is off the scale. Amid this, we learn that Iran is only weeks away from developing its first nuclear warhead. And also, we learn that America has just commissioned or built, or whatever you call it, a nuclear bomb that is 24 times more powerful than the bomb that destroyed Hiroshima. Meanwhile, we also hear that China is racking up its own nuclear arsenal. So there seems to be some kind of arms race going on here, particularly between the two superpowers, America and China. Given the backdrop of the Middle East, how worried should we be about this?
I think we should be. I mean, one of the things, again, we've taken our eye off the ball. The same way we took our eye off the ball over the Middle East. Classic thing, 2 weeks before October the 7th, we had the National Security Advisor of America saying he's not worried about what's going on.
It's all over.
I was shouting. And we've rather done the same thing with nuclear weapons. I mean, if you think back to the end of the Cold War and that whole period there, the so-called SALT talks and everything like that, it was all about controlling nuclear weapons. Since then, or nearly a generation later from that, we've let the nuclear genie back out of the bag again. We need to put it back.
Interesting.
Colonel Simon Diggins, thank you ever so much.